because everyone was about to run 81 kilometres, you'd imagine that there was a sort of a sense of trepidation, but actually there was a party atmosphere at the beginning of the long stage. People were dancing around. I think people were kind of, to be honest, masking the fact that they knew they had an extremely hard day ahead of themselves. I remember Patrick, the race organiser, though, suddenly saying, someone's not feeling well at the start, right up the front. And only later did I find out that some guy collapsed. The long day hadn't even begun. I mean, that it shows the level that people were pushing themselves to on certain points of the week. That sometimes their bodies just said no.
My name is Tom. I'm a BBC journalist, and I've taken a couple of weeks' holiday and paid nearly $6,000 of my own money to take on this extreme challenge. And I'm with some very good friends. Andy is a consultant who lives in New York.
Kind of perversely excited about trying to run 80 kilometres in this heat. That excitement will soon die down.
Oz is a banker, and he's from London.
This is 3 leagues above the most extreme experience I've ever had, and we haven't done the long day yet.
Will is a doctor, also in London.
Something is telling me just to keep going, keep going, keep going. Don't stop.
The Marathon des Sables, also known as the toughest race on earth, is run in a remote part of southern Morocco. We have 6 days to cover 220 kilometres across the desert, finishing up at Igadoun Tachbalt. We and hundreds of other men and women from all over the world have spent the last 3 days traversing the Sahara Desert in suffocating 40 to 50 degree heat. We've plodded over seemingly endless stretches of sandy, energy-sapping ground.
I hate the jeans.
15% of those who started the race won't make it to the finish. The man who created this crazy concept on a solo voyage through the desert is Frenchman Patrick Bauer. In the first race, 29 years ago, there were just 23 people.
Alors, ce qui m'a motivé à créer cette course, c'est que j'ai réalisé une expédition en solitaire au Sahara en 84. J'ai parcouru 350 km avec 35 kilos d'eau et de nourriture dans mon sac à dos pendant 12 jours. Et je suis rentré changé de cette traversée du désert. Et en rentrant chez moi, j'ai eu envie de faire partager cette expérience en créant une course aux mêmes caractéristiques, en tout cas proche des caractéristiques de mon expédition. Et j'ai créé le premier Marathon des Sables en 86.
Daybreak in the desert. Halfway through our challenge, we're still struggling with the uncomfortable living arrangements.
It's not a great place to sleep.
It's nice to wake up with the sunrise, though. At 5:30.
I have to be honest, there's a lot of things about being here that I'm not really enjoying.
Like?
Rubbish night's sleep, not having enough tissues to blow your nose, dirt always under your fingernails, not having really enough food. Like, the water never lasts me at night. Like, they give you 3 1.5-litre bottles, but I always finish it well before I get my next bottle.
The 1,000-odd runners need 120,000 litres of water to keep hydrated over the week. The water is rationed, so we pick up our allotted bottles in the morning and evenings and at the checkpoints along the race itself. We also have to carry all our clothes, kit and food across the desert. The organisers ensure that every runner has at least 14,000 calories for the week. But we want our rucksacks to be as light as possible, and that means no luxuries for us. So far, we've completed 112 kilometres in 3 days. But now we face our biggest challenge.
How long the distance? 81 kilometres.
Right. Yeah. How long have we got?
And 34 hours.
Completed. That's the maximum time?
Yes, maximum times, yeah.
We have to do two marathons in 1 day.
This one, you have one bottle.
No one in our group has run more than 50k in one go. And today we've got to do 81. So I think there's definitely a sense of trepidation.
The 81 kilometre stage of the Marathon des Sables will take us up mountains, over sand dunes, and along dried up riverbeds. And near the start, a beast of a mountain, the El Otfal Jebel, or Desert Mountain, has a 30% incline in places. We're 40 or so kilometres through the 81-kilometre double day, and Will is dehydrating more than most.
Yeah, I got quite dizzy, and then went to loo, and it was so concentrated, almost red. Basically, I'm very dehydrated. Hopefully, I feel better in a bit. Yeah, this is tough.
Our other inspiration was each other. Running in a team gives you a clear advantage.
I hope Oz is all right. I know.
Yeah.
Oz has been running with a bad knee. Will, Andy and myself push on.
On our minds throughout the morning was the fact that Oz had dropped back, that he was a distance behind us, and we had no idea how he was. And obviously we talked about the fact that we'd gone on ahead, and of course we felt a little bit guilty about it.
Our team of four is now a team of three. Oz is nowhere to be seen. The 81-kilometre stage of our desert challenge will take all day, and if all goes to plan, we'll be going late into the night. But we still don't know if Oz is okay. Until Will and Andy, arriving at a checkpoint, have a very welcome surprise.
That was really, really tough.
Oh, yes!
Come on!
I think I saw Andy first, gave him a big hug, and Will, and then saw Tom, who had passed through the checkpoint already. Probably my best moment of the marathon.
The main highlight for me was on the long day when we met up with Oz, who had dropped back 30 minutes, and we were hoping that he would catch us up, but we weren't sure. And then we saw him at the checkpoint. That was definitely the highlight of the week. It was fantastic to all be back together.
Bit of the strength. Okay. Glow sticks for the night.
Reunited, we're soon running and walking into the night.
You can only see, obviously, a few metres in front of you. You've got your head torch on. You're relying, really, on the step of the person in front of you.
There were moments on the kind of into the night of the long day where my body was very upset with me. And I really had to resist the urge to stop and sit down and lie down for a little nap for a bit.
Another one of my favourite moments was at the end of the long day, around midnight, when the four of us were lining up, when we found some energy to jog in the last few K, and just coming out the darkness with the four lights, seeing the finish line in sight was fantastic.
15 hours after we had set off earlier that morning, the finish line comes into sight.
That was fun. Well done. We did it.
Well done, guys.
Good effort. Amazing.
Sensation. Cheers. Cheers, guys. You kind of feel like you're drunk, which we're not at all.
No. Feels like it.
Your body's so tired. And then you're trying to trick your body into it. Like, we tried to run the bits that weren't sandy or juny enough. And you're just trying to kid your body that it's not tired.
Yeah.
It's very, very tired. It's not quite working the way it should.
God, you really feel for the guys who are out there and have got to checkpoint 4 and are bedding down for the night for like 4 or 5 hours and then getting up and doing another 30K. It's so difficult for them to do that.
I can't believe 81 kilometres. The furthest I've ever run was 24 miles. So after 41, which I actually was the first time I did was on Tuesday, it was all uncharted territory. So amazing. I feel brilliant. And now I need some food.
The last 2 hours were the darkest for me. Tonight was just a different experience. It was all right initially. Obviously, the novelty of the temperature dropping was great. But the monotony, like for example, the last checkpoint, we saw it miles off and it looked like it wasn't that far, but it just never arrived. Because you can't really judge distances in the dark when you can only see a bunch of lights in the distance.
There have been lots of people dropouts every day, but today there were a lot of people that were struggling up on the mountain, particularly with lack of water and with just misjudging the heat. I gave one guy some of my water because he was out and it was about 5Ks still to go in the middle of the day.
The next day is a rest day. Time to deal with the effects of a double marathon through the desert.
I think I'm losing the fingernail there.
The fingernail on your toe.
The fingernail, the toenail. Doesn't look nice.
For others, it's time to reflect on the brutality of the challenge.
I'd been running already for 18 hours and I knew I still had 3 to go. My feet were so painful that I could only hobble and I had blisters everywhere and I knew I was bleeding because I could feel the blood in my shoes. And at that stage, you know you've got 3 hours. 3 hours is a long, long time when you're in such pain. But a running partner came along, we joined up together, and then 3 hours later it was done and we walked through the dawn and over the finish line.
And time to think about some of the desert stories of inspiration, like Mike, who we share a tent with.
The story is summed up in an email I got this afternoon from my occupational therapist, who saw me after I'd been knocked off my bike training for another event, ended up with a fractured skull and a stroke, which lost use of my left arm, left leg, and I couldn't walk 100 yards. So her task, she said, was to get me to walk 100 yards in 3 months. I said, that's not quite what I had in mind. And here I am, 16 months later, done 220 kilometres. And then last February, I was diagnosed with a form of leukaemia. And I had to start chemotherapy. So each night here, I have to take chemotherapy tablets, which kill off my red blood cells, which makes me unsuitable for endurance events. So the doctors say.
Hi.
Our only contact with the outside world are the emails from friends and family, which are printed off and brought to our tent every night.
That's nice here from Rosie and Sebi.
By doing this challenge, we're also raising money for two charities. One works to fight cancer, and the other, Parkinson's disease. My dad has cancer. So does Andy's fiancé's mum, and his mum has Parkinson's.
You do start to kind of link it to other things that are going on in your life or in the life of your family and friends, and so people that are undergoing treatment or have kind of bad news, and you start to convince yourself that you're running for that.
My wife was amazing. She sent me maybe three or four emails a day, and she just said constantly how proud she was of me. And so when I'm running, I'm thinking I'm making my wife proud, and that makes me happy and makes me want to push on more.
Even my dad from hospital was sending like messages via the rest of my family, and getting messages from them was hugely, hugely important, because it made you realise that even though you're in the middle of the desert doing something really crazy where you're putting your health at risk, you knew that there was a load of people back home thinking about you and rooting for you and basically with you.
...32 hours after setting off, the last runners emerge from the desert, and everyone turns out to welcome them in. The final day. Just one marathon left to run, and today we change tactics.
Just before the start on the last day, we kind of said, shall we stay together? Can we go off on our own pace? Andy and I had both said that we wouldn't mind seeing how fast we could do the final marathon stage.
On the last day, it was nice to have a bit of solo time as well, which felt very, very different. It's just you against the world, and you're running as fast as you can go.
After running so far, over several days, running a marathon through the desert suddenly doesn't seem too bad.
Obviously, the fact that my dad is really ill at the moment with cancer has been an additional motivation. You know, I've seen him battling his illness, and like the courage and kind of determination that he's showing in really kind of at times adverse circumstances. And of course, I've drawn strength from that. He's had a second operation, which thankfully went okay. And I said to my dad, you know, you're amazing, like, well done for, you know, going through a second operation again on your spine. It's a serious thing. He's pretty ill. He's doing amazingly. He's battling every day. What my dad's going through is 10 million times harder than running the marathon to Sable.
Will, Andy and Oz are still behind me. And it's Will who's suffering the most.
I've got pain in my left ankle, right knee. My blisters have just all ripped apart, so they're just red, it's just red raw skin. I've got blood in my urine, but something is telling me just to keep going, keep going, keep going. Don't stop. It's harder today without the guys. But you just have to go at your own pace. This is the hardest thing I've ever done. Definitely. And I thought the long day would be the hardest. But actually, it just gets harder and harder and harder.
Andy is also struggling.
On the last day, I started to get a little bit emotional, which was quite strange. And I think partly the body was very tired, and I was running as fast as I could. And it's a bit silly because it's only a run.
My bag started breaking, so my bottle started falling out my bag, which was very, very upsetting. It's funny when you're so tired how upsetting things like that are. Like, it crushed me that I had to stop and change my bottles.
Did you cry? Did you have a little cry?
I almost had a little cry. And then I had to have a word to myself and say, pull yourself together and sort it out, it doesn't matter.
My fiancé had written a little note for each day that I was going to read to kind of, before I left for each stage of the race. And I left that final note until I'd finished the race. So I kind of read that and I thought about her and her mum and Tom's dad and my mum and had a little cry at that moment, which seemed to be quite common as people cross that line.
I surprised myself, finishing 40th on the final day.
Je suis très content de gagner la 29e édition de marathon de Sables.
Vraiment, c'était une très belle aventure.
Then the moment we've been waiting for.
Ah, yes.
Yes. Yes.
All four of us reunited at the finish line of one of the toughest races in the world.
As soon as I saw Oz, I was like, okay, I can just stay on his ankles and just drag myself through.
There was a struggle, but we got there in the end. It was nice.
Mate, thank you so much for getting me through. Awesome.
And I'm looking forward to my kiss.
It's taken us around 40 hours of running and walking 220 kilometres across the Sahara, with several kilos of food and kit on our backs to reach this point.
Well, we were joking that we should definitely return and tell our other halves that we've signed up for something else more crazy.
I've never really run more than 6 or 7 miles, and I've never, in a competition, run more than 5.5 kilometres.
That satisfaction of completing something like this, like a massive challenge with some really close mates, I don't think you can get that sense of achievement, that sense of feeling in many things in life.
Doing it again, I definitely won't do, but I don't regret doing it. It was a great experience, and it was something that I've definitely taken a lot away from.
I'm very happy that I'll never have to do it again.
There's nothing extraordinary about me, and this is one of the whole things. I just wanted to do something that was an extraordinary thing to do.